Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Mark Dirks, and on behalf of ACRL in Choice, I'd like to welcome you to today's program, Case Studies on the Impact of eBook Archives at North American University Libraries, which is sponsored by Springer Nature. Today's discussion is one in a series of sponsored webinars from ACRL in Choice that addresses new ideas, developments, and products of interest to the academic library community. Free to users, these structured 60-minute live presentations provide the opportunity for interactive discussions of important new issues and developments in academic librarianship by librarians, vendors, authors, and other interested stakeholders. Before we get started, I would like to point out a few features of the webinar software. In the main area of the screen, you should be able to follow along with the presentation materials. Along the right-hand side, you should see a Q&A panel and a chat panel. If you don't, you can click the button with a little dialog cloud and the button labeled Q&A at the bottom of your screen to activate the panels. The Q&A button may be in the little three-dot option as well. At the end of the presentation, our speakers will take a few minutes to answer your questions, so please do send them in throughout. And if you experience any technical issues, that's what the chat panel's for. Let me know, and I can troubleshoot the issue with you privately. Today, we are using the hashtag ACRLChoiceWebinars. So if you have another screen handy, shout out to us. We're at choice_reviews on Twitter. Also note that we are recording today's program, and everyone who registered should receive a follow-up with a link to the archived version. All right. And with that, I'm going to transition over to Matt.
Yeah, thanks very much, Mark. Thanks for the introduction. Hi, everyone. Thanks for joining us. Good afternoon or good morning, depending on where you are in the Americas. My name is Matt Peck, and I'm going to just give an introduction about myself. I'm Content Marketing Manager for eBooks at Springer Nature in the UK. So my daily view from the kitchen, and there's our office. If you're ever in town, please do give us a shout. We'd be happy to give you a little tour. I'm currently sat in an office in the Netherlands where it's 7 p.m., but I'm happy that you guys are joining us, and Springer Nature are very happy to sponsor this ACRL Choice webinar. So I'm not going to talk about myself. We're obviously going to talk about the eBooks archive. So on the next slide, I'm going to introduce our speakers. So before I introduce those guys, I just want to give a bit of information in terms of the learning objective today. So what do we hope to share? Well, generally speaking, we're just going to give you some examples of how an eBook archive has been acquired and implemented at our universities here. We'll give some info on sort of how it was implemented, how it was used, whether the acquisition has proven to be a success, whether researchers are using the content, and just sort of get an in-depth overview of the experiences of our three librarians adopting an eBook archive. As Mark said, there will be time to ask questions at the end. Do feel free to type away during the session. I will be collating them and passing those on to our three presenters at the end of the session. So our three speakers today, we have Denise Novak, who is acquisitions librarian at Carnegie Mellon. We have Trish Chatterley, who is Collections Strategies Coordinator at University of Alberta. And then finally, we have John Meyer, who is Science Librarian at Penn State. I'm shortly going to hand over to Denise, but just to give you a bit of information, Denise is the Head of Acquisitions for Carnegie Mellon University Libraries. Before coming to Carnegie Mellon, she was Head of Acquisitions and Collections Development at the University of Evansville in Indiana. Previously, Denise held positions at the Fort Worth Public Library in Texas and the Louisville Free Public Library in Kentucky. She is former president and treasurer of NASIG and has served on committees and task forces of several professional library organizations, including NASIG and ALCTS. So without further ado, I'd just like to hand over to Denise.
Thank you, Matt. Very much appreciated. You are looking at the Hunt Library lit up at night here in Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania, and I want to tell you how the impact of eBook archives has affected the Carnegie Mellon University Libraries. Carnegie Mellon University is a global research university of approximately 14,600 students who represent 114 countries. Over 5,000 faculty and staff representing 48 countries work and teach at the main Pittsburgh campus, Silicon Valley campus, and our campus in Qatar. The university libraries in Pittsburgh are made up of three separate libraries. The Hunt Library houses fine arts, humanities, and the social sciences. It's recently become the home of the Integrative Design, Arts, and Technology Network, also known as ID8, which offers several multidisciplinary minors on campus. The Sorrells Library holds the engineering, material science, computer science, and robotics collections, and the Mellon Institute Library contains biology, chemistry, and other life sciences collections. Hunt Library was built in 1960, and at that time, the Carnegie Institute of Technology, as it was known, had an enrollment of 3,500 full-time students with 1,600 part-time evening students. Today, the enrollment at Carnegie Mellon University in Pittsburgh is over 14,000. We have eBook archives and packages for two major reasons. One is the greater availability of eBooks by more users, and the second, and I think more importantly, is that we have space concerns within the libraries here on campus. The student population is one of the reasons the university libraries made the decision to purchase archival eBook packages. Physical space at Hunt Library and the Sorrells Library has become a big issue. There isn't enough room for students to study alone and or collaborate in groups. And there have been other departments and programs on campus that wanted to use part of the libraries. What you're looking at right now is what used to be the reference area of the university library, as well the Hunt Library. And now that's the home of the GCC, which is also the Global Communication Center that we have here in the library. So, we lost all of our reference space with the exception of a couple of book ranges. The area that you're looking at right now was at one time the reserve area of Hunt Library, which is now a cafe and study area. The cafe being very important to the students. So the decision was made to ruthlessly weed the print collection in the Hunt Library and Sorrells Library in order to create space for more study and collaborative study. So books were either discarded or sent to our off-site storage facility. This is the Sorrells Library in the midst of the renovation and all of the empty bookshelves. And this is Sorrells Library post-renovation. Many, many areas for collaboration, many areas for students just to lie on pillows around the floor and study, talk. There are individual study rooms and group study rooms. It's become very, very popular. Looking at this from a collection development perspective, eBook archives are expensive. We have an expensive purchases committee which reviews requests made for one-time purchases, like back files and archive collections, and it's with those funds that purchases are made. And we have a hard time getting a handle on how we were going to catalog these things when they came in, and it was the cataloging librarian who put all of the records in for all of our eBook archive packages. However, we have a new ILS, which is Alma Primo, and that has changed our workflow entirely. Most of the materials that are ordered are down, the records are downloaded from the Alma Community Zone into our catalog, or the acquisition staff who order the books make sure that the records are uploaded into Alma Primo. We have seen steady use and growth in usage as evidenced by our statistics. And this is just 1 year of the use of eBook archives, well, 2 years actually, 2017 and 2018 through this September. And it shows very healthy growth and a lot of use, which made us very happy because we weren't sure how eBooks were going to go over with the students and, well, really with faculty, because sometimes our faculty are a little resistant to change, but we have not found that to be the case. And based on our statistics, I think eBook archives have been very, very successful, and we're looking forward to buying many more of these archives in the future. Thanks very much.
Thanks so much, Denise. Really interesting presentation, and to all of our viewers, if you do have questions, they might come to you at some point. Please just type them in, and we can come back to Denise at the end when we have our Q&A session. But thanks for now, Denise. Thanks so much. Next up, we have Trish Chatterley. So Trish is Collections Strategies Coordinator at the University of Alberta in Edmonton, Canada. Prior to becoming head of the acquisitions unit, she was involved with monograph acquisitions for the University of Alberta Libraries, including ebook packages, demand-driven acquisition programs, and approval plans. And just to mention that University of Alberta is an electronic preferred library that provides access to extensive ebook collections. So over to you, Trish.
Great, thank you, and hello, everyone. I am coming to you from the University of Alberta Libraries, and so I wanted to just give a bit of context about what I will refer to as the U of A, in case it's unfamiliar to many of you. So we are located in Edmonton, Alberta, Canada, and Alberta is in the province directly north of Montana. We were a university founded in 1908, and we currently serve approximately 37,000 students and have 9,000 faculty and staff on campus. We are a member library of both the Association of Research Libraries as well as the Canadian equivalent of CARL. We have 6 subject libraries on our main campus, representing the Humanities and Social Sciences, a Science and Technology Library, a Health Sciences Library, focusing on all the health sciences, including medicine, nursing, rehab med, dentistry, pharmacy, and public health. We have an education library, a business library, and a law library. We also have 2 off-campus sites that are undergraduate campuses. One is our Campus Saint-Jean, which collects primarily French-Canadian material. And our Augustana campus is located in a town called Camrose, about an hour south of Edmonton. We're a very large library system with about 8 million print volumes, and we're nearing 1.5 million ebooks. We're very fortunate to have a healthy collections budget of close to 25 million Canadian, which works out, depending on the day, today it's about 19.3 million US dollars. Of the 25 million Canadian, 20 million are devoted to subscriptions, about 3.5 million for monographs, and the remainder to some cataloging contracts, digitization, and various other odds and ends. Now, I know different libraries classify expenditures a little bit differently, so I should point out that some of what falls under subscriptions are actually purchases of ebooks. We have 1 fund code designated for any product with an ongoing annual cost, and 1 code for any one-time purchase, whether it's a single book or a large primary source database that we might buy at year end. So it's a very simple budgeting structure. And with the publisher direct frontlist purchases that we acquire, we do consider them as subscriptions, even though they're purchases, because we intend to purchase them annually on an ongoing basis, and this allows us to budget more effectively. We moved to an electronic preferred policy for the acquisition of monographs back in 2014. This move was made for a number of reasons, the main one being enhanced accessibility to a greater number of students. We acknowledge that students are searching for and using information very differently now than they did even a few years ago, and they don't want to wait for the perfect book if it's already checked out by somebody else. They're working on their projects all hours of the day and night, often at the last minute, so there's many benefits to having ebook access at home when needed. And we also see an increasing number of distance education programs being offered, so ebooks serve those programs much more efficiently than print books. I wanted to provide a bit of an overview of our overall approach to purchasing English language monographs, as this really plays into why we make decisions about purchasing ebook archives. As I mentioned, we are e-preferred. And our starting point for acquiring eBooks is through the purchase of Publisher Direct front list packages. So we acquire front lists from a variety of publishers, Springer, Elsevier, Wiley, the large interdisciplinary ones, as well as for some smaller subject-specific publishers like the Royal Society of Chemistry or Karger for medical texts. Buying Publisher Direct eBooks is our preferred method for a number of reasons. One being the DRM-free model. Our users benefit from unlimited simultaneous access to these titles. And because we're buying the titles in volume, we see a reduced cost per title. There are benefits for discovery as well. We know from our statistics that users don't necessarily start their search at the library website, they're going to Google. And so when they're IP authenticated on campus, they can go directly to publisher platforms via Google searches and gain immediate access to the content there. It's not quite as seamless on aggregator platforms. We do buy eBooks on aggregators as well through approval plans that we have set up through ProQuest Coop. So the publishers from whom we buy the front list, they're excluded, but the other publishers, we have criteria, and if titles match those criteria, the eBooks move into a demand-driven acquisition stream, so they're readily available, but we only buy them when users actually click into them. We do have a separate, smaller DDA program through JSTOR as well. If titles aren't available for DDA, because some publishers don't allow that, we acquire eBooks on our approval plan, through Coots on both the eBook Central and EBSCO platform. If eBooks aren't available, only then do we acquire print books on our approval plan, and there's an 8-week delay. So if an eBook isn't available within 8 weeks of the print coming out, we'll purchase the print. And then the only firm orders we place are via requests that we receive from students or faculty. We don't, our liaison librarians don't do any title by title selection. We preferentially try to purchase monographs where we can. We do have some subscription packages as well, including EBSCO and ProQuest. So while we moved to electronic books as our preferred format in 2014, we actually began purchasing a lot of eBooks much earlier than that. Springer was the first publisher direct front list we began acquiring, and that was back in 2005, and we've been purchasing it ever since. In March 2017, at the end of our last fiscal year, we ended up purchasing the full eBook archive. We are a Canadian institution, and most of our invoices are paid in U.S. dollars, which means we're subject to currency exchange rate fluctuations, which often can put us in a very precarious position, but sometimes puts us in a positive position as well. If we have spent more on invoices in the previous year, we find ourselves with money available at year-end to put towards larger purchases, and that's the position we found ourselves in last year. Because the Canadian dollar had been more favorable than the year before, we, for the first time, had sufficient funds to buy the eBook archive. We knew that we had much of that content in print already. Unlike Denise, space constraints weren't a factor in our decision. We knew that our users would benefit from the eBook, and if it came to that, we could move our print subscriptions to our brand new offsite storage facility, but it wasn't necessary. We actually haven't systematically moved anything there as of yet. We knew that our users had been denied access to archival content over the years. We had received a few requests from students and faculty to indicate, you know, that they would like to have access to an eBook version, but we weren't able to fill those requests because titles weren't available for sale individually, and we hadn't been able to purchase the full archive of the collection. The year prior to our decision, in 2016, the stats showed that there were about 28,000 turnaways from the content, which seems like a fairly significant number. And so we decided that if that reflected what future use might be in preventing similar turnaways and frustration, it would be a positive move for us. So we did move ahead. We cataloged all of the records. We imported the mark into our catalog. And in that first year, because we've made it at the end of fiscal, for the first 9 months, I should say, in 2017, we saw over 200,000 downloads of the archival content. So the denials weren't necessarily reflective of the use we could have anticipated with the enhanced discovery that was rolled in through the importing of the MARC records. So our total number of downloads for that period was 975,000. So with 200,000 coming from the archive, over 20% of the use did come from those what might have considered older texts and not immediately relevant to current users' needs. Looking a little more closely at some of the usage statistics, we saw that there are a few titles that were used very heavily. Often these are textbook materials. In 2017, the top used title was called Linear Algebra. It was published in 1984. And again, the denials didn't necessarily reflect the use that we might have anticipated. There were only 10 denials the year before, and that escalated to about 2,500 uses in 9 months of 2017. Overall, for the archive that year, about 8,400 titles received some use. A few titles had a lot of use, like into the thousands. A few had, quite a few actually, had hundreds of titles, and then there was sort of a long tail of low-used items, like one or two hits. Just looking at some of the categories then, we do see a fair amount of use across all of the subject areas. We are a large research university with programming in these areas, so we didn't have to select just certain collections to acquire. We purchased the whole kit and the caboodle. So from a public service perspective, there has been some positivity to this. Before we would, have requests that we had to deny, in this case we don't have to, there's a sort of a seamless view on the platform. There should be no title from which a user gets turned away. So we can inform patrons for any Springer title and Palgrave title as well that we are able to give them access. So this is, the Springer Archive is just one of many ebook archives that we have purchased. We also have Cambridge, Sage, Bloomsbury, and a number of packages as well. So this Springer acquisition did factor well into our overall strategy for ebook acquisition. So that's all from me. Thanks very much for your attention, and I will turn it back to Matt.
Thanks so much, Trish. Thanks very much. Really interesting presentation. Nice to see some positive usage trends. Guys, again, just a reminder that if you do have any questions, please do type them in. I can see that we have a couple come through already, but we will obviously collate these and field them to our presenters at the end. So moving on to our next speaker. Next, I'm going to introduce John Meyer. So John is a science librarian at the Physical and Mathematical Sciences Library in the Pennsylvania State University Libraries at University Park. His responsibilities include instruction, collection development, reference and investigating methods of delivering library information and services to the departments of mathematics and statistics. He's also the Patent and Trademark Resource Center librarian for Penn State. A couple of more things about John. He holds an MLIS from the University of Pittsburgh and an MS in Electrical and Computer Engineering from Carnegie Mellon University. And finally, his current research interests lie in using rapid prototyping in the library and leadership in higher education. So I'm going to hand over to John now.
Thanks a lot, Matt. So I wanted to say I'm glad to go third, partially because I'm going to echo some of the things my colleagues from Carnegie Mellon University of Alberta have said, and they've set a stage for a lot of the approaches that Penn State also takes to acquisition. A little bit of facts about Penn State University. So we are in the top 10 ARL expenditure rankings for a large research university. We have about 7 million, almost 7 million titles, including 2 million ebooks. So we have a comprehensive doctoral program, almost any subject that there is be interest at Penn State University. But I'm going to focus mostly on the physical and mathematical sciences, which are astronomy and astrophysics, chemistry, mathematics, physics, and statistics. So Penn State has over 20 campuses, and we have one dean. So the university libraries has one budget for all campuses. Here at University Park, we have five separate branch libraries oriented around different subjects. So this has caused us some difficulties in sometimes negotiating with publishers with regards to subscriptions or one-time purchases. Equivalent, we have about 85,000 FTE of students, and so we are usually out of most of the brackets that they set up for student use. But given how we're driven by our budget and by our university's mission to be one university geographically dispersed, even our World Campus program is considered to have the same degree as any campus when someone graduates, we have an imperative to negotiate pretty hard on our license agreements, and this can mean for years that we are unable to purchase some things that we are looking to and that are desirable, but even with a very large budget, things don't always fit the scale. So let me focus in on the history of the Springer Book Archive as a particular example of this. So there was first interest back in, in 2000, we had the 2005 front list as well of ebook titles through our agreements, and especially particularly with the Big Ten Academic Alliance. And around 2013, we saw a high use in certain subjects. So for example, mathematics had almost 100,000 downloads from the 2005 to 2013 window in just a year. And we did only, like Trish said, we only had about, maybe 500 denials from the archives around 2013. So we weren't sure what if the demand just justified the cost. But we did see demand for individual book requests as well. So a book in the archives we would like to buy as an ebook, but it was only sold as part of the book archive. And so we were building up that demand, both individual requests, turnaways, and some of the trends we were seeing around the library world. So we negotiated for a couple of years, and we were able to, in 2015, buy some of the most in-demand subject collections, in particular math, earth and environmental science, and chemistry and material science. So we also have a budget that is divided up among recurring costs and one-time purchases. We have money set aside in recurring costs by subject area, but one-time purchases is decided by a committee in consultation with our associate dean. And so in those negotiations, it took about 2 years to sort of show enough value with the Springer Book Archive. In particular, in my case, I made the argument for the mathematics collection, which also included a large number of key series from Springer in mathematics. And these go back over 100 years, so there was quite a depth in the book archive. So let me show you a bit of the use. So we already had that heavy use of Springer books both online and in paper. As when it comes to mathematics publishing, there's Springer, there's the American Mathematical Society, and a few other publishers are the main ones that mathematicians, graduate students, and undergraduates look to for the books, textbooks, through research monographs. Also, mathematics is a bit different from other sciences where older books can retain importance and use for a long time. We did a use study of our collection based on citation data and circulation data, and it showed that our practical use of the collection for chemistry would be about 10 years, physics about 20 years, and mathematics about 50 years. That would be in the most heavy use. And so mathematics is something that an archive of the books would be particularly important. Finally, as was mentioned before, there are frequently textbooks which also are older, some not reused year to year, that are required. And for us, that's a big win with so many students across a bunch of campuses. If a particular book is available as an ebook, particularly with multiple available users, we would find that to be used very heavily. So just as a summary of our last year's statistics, you can see that the collections that we have, the archive for, are extremely high in their use, so mathematics and statistics at the top, and then chemistry, material science, computer science, where there's overlap as well with mathematics, earth and environmental science as the third, among, you know, how you see the subject breakdown. We do not have all the collections, and so you can see that the ones we do are the ones that are garnering the highest usage. So what were my reactions, keeping track of when we purchased in 2015, the archive? So immediately we saw a very high use for a few titles. And this proved to happen year to year. We did a couple of studies comparing use of print reserves textbooks that we have in the library and the number of downloads of ebooks where we had data available. And so immediately we could see very high use for some of the Springer mathematics textbooks. And overall, if you look at every book in the collection, you'll see a distribution with a very long tail. So you would see maybe a dozen books with over 1,000 uses. And then for the remainder, it trails off to most of the books having just one use, which is fine because, well, if you think about textbooks in the affordability initiative that universities, Penn State as one of them, trying to make universities more affordable to our students, a big burden is sometimes textbook costs. And we can say with one book that's used by 1,000 students at, you know, $100 or more, we're saving $100,000 or more for Penn State students, and that has a big impact, especially on high enrollment courses. You know, that's not available through all publishers, and it's not available for all textbooks, but when it is, it can really have a big impact with very small investment. Or in case of the Springer Book Archive, a large investment that is recuperating that cost to Penn State over time. What are the other benefits of this particular ebook platform? So the lack of digital rights management is very important to our users and to us as professionals. The ability to say you can download the book, you can download a chapter, you can read it on whatever device you're on. If there are multiple people trying to use the book at the same time, they won't be denied. Which is kind of a ridiculous artificial barrier that is not in place for the students. And actually, from some of our faculty, we've had a high use of the My Copy feature, and I've gotten, you know, just anecdotal evidence that this is something that is heavily used on our campus, and I promote it whenever I'm talking to students in a class as something that they can do for low cost on their own. So what other ways, other than showing the Springer Book Archive in classrooms and mentioning the My Copy feature? Well, when we first acquired the collection in 2015, I sent out a general announcement to the faculty list and graduate student email list to announce that we had the collection. We got some individual feedback that it was very anticipated and it was well received. But then we started to do targeted emails, in particular to courses that were already using a Springer textbook in their class. So I would go to the course listings and required textbooks, identify all the books for all the mathematics and statistics classes in a semester, pull out the ones which were from Springer, and being able to create a customized link for that instructor with the proxy information for their off-campus students, send that link to them with suggestions before the semester started. You know, a few weeks before the semester, we would send this message. It would say, well, I say you've used this textbook in the past, or this textbook is required for your class. Did you know we had an eBook copy of it that any number of students can use? Feel free to put this link in your syllabus or in our learning management system, Canvas, for your students to use. And that started a few years ago, and the feedback was somewhat immediate. You know, some faculty would respond, thank you. Others would respond, hey, do you have this additional book for another class? And it became a regular program over a couple of years, and after a while it began to get unsolicited responses where I would get an email, I'm going to teach a class in the future. Do you have any textbooks that are eBooks that would make a good choice? And then we could look at our eBook collections, we could look at open access textbooks, open educational resources, and help those faculty find those. So it's been a great outreach tool, and it's one of multiple eBook platforms we do have. You know, we also lease collections. We have made outright collections from some other publishers, which we prefer to do. And I find that they will not always be discovered through our discovery layer. Sometimes they'll come from the web. But we try to meet the curricular need in particular as a way to talk about what's coming or what can be useful to the students. And hopefully we're getting a little earlier in the process so then we can also help faculty when they're planning their semester. So other benefits, much like Alberta, we didn't go into this thinking that we were going to remove a lot of books, but we did have the ability through both a shared journal archive, print journals through the Big Ten Academic Alliance to withdraw most of our bound journal collections. We were able to, in some cases, put our book series and our books that are in eBook collections into storage, on campus remote storage. And a combination of those two initiatives really helped us to free up half of our physical space in the science library. So this is a picture of the physical and mathematical sciences library post renovations. And you can see on the left, there are quite a few bookshelves. Our stacks there are almost continuous to the back of the building. And they have some study carrels around them, but they're mostly just collections. If you can imagine that on the right side as well, we did reduce our footprint of books on site almost by 50%. And so we added over 100 more seats, doubled the number of computers, added 5 new group study reservable spaces, and a number of tables for collaborative work. And it really helped to transform our physical space. Now, most books older than 10 years in subjects I mentioned before, chemistry in particular, had been put into storage. But we did keep quite a high number of mathematics books, even from Springer, in the library. One change we made was to take some of the book series, like Graduate Studies in Mathematics, and instead of classifying them by series, we reclass them by LC call number in order to aid browsing. And that's been a lukewarm response. As many people are, you know, shocked and say, I used to know exactly which volume in the thousands that I was looking for, and now they're out of order, I have to look it up in the catalog. To those who can now browse it and find a book on the shelf, that's actually in the subject area they're looking for when it's classed by LC subject area heading. So those are some changes that have resulted from multiple eBook collections that we've acquired, along with some print journal archiving that we've done as part of the Big Ten Academic Alliance. So that's all I have. I'll send it back to Matt.
Great. Thanks so much, John. Really interesting presentation, as I'm sure our audience agree. We have plenty of questions through what you've been talking as well. Before we dive into the questions, guys, we had a little chat where we were talking about orientations over the past couple of weeks and thought it'd be a good idea to provide some final thoughts and just understand about what similarities we've identified between our three university libraries. We tried to narrow it down into four areas, and I just want to give you a little overview. So in terms of what sort of matched across, we found that in general, starting at the top left there, that textbooks in general had high usage. They were well used in proportion to other book types. You might find that the number of textbooks in a collection may be between 8 and 10% of overall titles, yet the usage is much, much higher. So it's good to see that our textbooks are being used. Students are finding them and they're making use of them, which is positive. Moving over to the top right, historical material is still valued, which sometimes might not be the case, but evidence has shown here that our three university libraries are seeing usage out of the historical content, and we've identified across the board that, generally speaking, the popular archive subject areas for usage were mathematics and statistics, chemistry, and computer science. Largely speaking, computer science is always up there, as may or may not be aware, but lecture notes in computer science sits inside that, so that tends to bump up usage. Moving down to the bottom left, we found that full access tends to lead to less confusion. So whereas with contemporary content, you might have some copyright year gaps, in terms of the archive, would have a block of content going from 2004 backwards. And generally speaking, the majority of titles from those copyright years are used, and there's no sort of access denied when somebody in your FTE stumbles across a title that might fall into one of those copyright year gaps. So that would be one of the benefits of the archive. And then finally, we all agreed that, generally speaking, students do benefit. They don't have to go and buy the text themselves. They're saving money with the online access. And I'm sure if you're aware, there's also the option for My Copy, which means that if your institution licenses the title, your student or researcher can purchase a print copy of the title for $25. Also, the aspect of no digital rights management, so as many people can use it concurrently, is very helpful. We've had some questions here about that, which I'll come back to. And in terms of shelf space being freed up, and I think we saw a couple of examples there, the shelf space was freed up and there's more space for student study,
student areas.
Like I said, we will go into questions, but just to quickly talk to you about Spring and Nature webinars in general, we are continuing to partner with ACRL Choice into 2019 with more webinars, so please do keep a lookout for those. We do also run our own series of webinars on springandnature.com/4librarians. We have a whole host of recordings on there as well. Please do check it out. And just in terms of ebook collections in general, if you are interested in finding out more information, simply go to springandnature.com/4librarians. We have a products section, and there's all the information on our ebook collections, including the archives, on there. Or, of course, you can contact me after this webinar or reach out to your licensing manager. Okay. Now, we'll get on to some questions. We have had quite a few through. We do still have 16 and a half minutes, so we'll try and blast through these. But thank you all for your comments as we've been going along. First question is to all three speakers, and if we go Denise first, Trish, and then John as we did in the speakers. So just basically confirming, in terms of the usage stats, was the number for chapter downloads, or was it for book downloads overall?
The usage stats were at the chapter level.
Cool.
Yeah.
Thank you. And John and Denise?
Our ebook statistics came straight from the statistics that I get every month when I go into the portal.
Cool, yeah. So that would be chapter downloads, yeah?
Yeah.
Yeah, the BR2 counter reports.
Okay, cool. And I'm assuming that will be the same for you as well, John, I presume.
Yeah, that's the same at Penn State.
Awesome. So that's a nice question to start with. Okay, this one I think we can talk about quite a bit. So this comes from Susanna. Thanks, Susanna. So it's a question for everyone. And John, I'll come to you first on this. So Suzanne says, because I can see that all of you are from big universities and have big budgets for purchasing, but for those of us who have a small budget, I'm curious what strategies you've developed in growing your ebook archive in that case. And if you just give us a reminder about your FTE size first, and then maybe talk to us about your strategies for growing the ebook archive, and I'll come to you first, John.
I'm happy to talk about this because I worked for a number of years. I had considered saving money, carrying over funds year to year, if that was possible. I sent out inquiries to Springer about doing an installment plan. So because of the high cost, spreading that over 3 years, you know, committing to it, making a purchase, but then paying over 3 years. So within the larger budget, the math budget is actually one of the smallest among the sciences in particular. And so dealing with purchases, for example, the American Mathematical Society as well, we just try to do one a year or one portion of a collection a year when we really even can't just buy everything we actually want. So I have a wish list. I've prioritized it. That feeds into a larger wish list with priorities. And sometimes it's cost, you know, but hopefully there's an ability to spread the cost of a larger collection that can't be broken up over multiple years or another way. We have been able to do a few consortial agreements, but mostly that is for subscriptions rather than one-time purchases.
This is Denise Novak, and although we are Carnegie Mellon University, we are lean and mean, and I have to say our materials budget is not as high as Penn State or Alberta, not at all. So what we've done in the past is we've used the installment plan. We have coughed up some of our endowment funds, our library endowment funds for specific purposes. We save year to year because as a private institution, we don't lose our budget at the end of the year. We can roll it over. And we have a big wish list. And we also try to work through our consortia for some purchases.
Thanks, Denise. Yes. Perfect, thank you. And did you have anything to add as well, Trish?
Sure, just a comment about budgeting and funding structure. I alluded to our very simplistic approach to budgeting where we have two fund codes, one for ongoing and one for one time. We don't parcel it out by different subject areas. We try to take a holistic approach to collection development, which allows us greater flexibility. So at the end of the year, we're not trying to figure out dollars within math or computer science. We can, you know, spend more on one subject area 1 year and less the next, and to try to make it work that way. So the simplified structure really does allow a lot of flexibility in that regard.
Perfect. Thanks, Trish. Thanks, everyone, for those very thorough answers. So we will move on to the next question, and it is from Naomi. Thank you, Naomi. So I will come to you first, Trish, with this one. So do faculty ever approach you as a librarian to see if there is an ebook already available that would be appropriate for textbook use?
Right. Generally, when we hear from faculty, they have a specific title in mind rather than approaching us to say, do you have an appropriate textbook on such and such a topic? So John might have a different response given some of their outreach. So we do try to, as an e-preferred library, acquire unlimited access ebooks whenever we know that a title is being used as a required reading for a course. It's not always possible. Not all publishers allow their textbooks to be unpublished, but we try to accommodate where we can.
Perfect, thank you. Did you want to comment on that as well, John?
Sure, and I think if looking at the whole picture, including multiple campuses, it is the rarity where still faculty will come to us at the textbook choosing stage, or even now, I did just talk to someone this semester who's not using any textbooks, but they want to pick and choose chapters out of multiple books, which is really possible now with a lot of the chapter-by-chapter ebook platforms like Springer. So I think if you look at, say, 100 math classes, half of them, the book isn't even available as an ebook. For example, Stewart's Calculus is not available from whatever publisher that is. And then among those remaining ones, maybe half, a quarter of the total is multiple user ebooks. So the other ones may be restricted to single user at a time. And then even among those, maybe less than five are like open educational resources or an open access textbook. So it's still hugely a print driven textbook, and it is driven by the faculty, that there it is rare but hopefully growing where you have a conversation to steer especially a large enrollment or a multi-section class towards using a different textbook.
Perfect. Thanks, John. And Denise, did you want to add anything?
We're not really involved in the textbook question at this point. It's a faculty decision, and the bookstore has a lot to do with the purchasing of textbooks. So I can't even say we're in that equation.
Okay. Well, no, that's good. It's good to get different perspectives, definitely. Thank you. Thanks to all three of our speakers there. I've got a couple of Springer Nature specific questions which I'm going to take, and then I'll come back to some more questions for our speakers. So again, from Naomi, are the OA Springer titles included in the archives? So Naomi, the Springer Nature Open Access book program started in 2011. So generally speaking, unless an older book has been flipped to OA, which I don't believe they have, I would say, or categorically, that's a no. So I guess that's question is regarding the fact that usage is quite high. That would be organic usage and not related to open access. Dundee asks, what is the year of the coverage for the archives? So Dundee, is anything before 2005? So 2004 backwards, copyright year. And David, I will come back to your question for our colleagues here. But first of all, you ask if Audible ebooks are available. Not at the moment, but we are doing a lot of research into the future of the book, and I would suggest that you and anybody else that is interested in this Google future of the book, Springer Nature. The first result that comes up is information called Leading the Future of the Book, and it's put together by our chief book strategist, Dr. Nails Peter Thomas. And I mean, his research is into like looking at neurological research on reading and learning, looking at using like the virtual reality headsets to read a book, behind the science behind where you look from like left to right and whether you could read a book like that. It's a new area that we're looking into, how multimedia plays a role in the future reading of the book, and I highly encourage to look at that. So just a reminder, it's called Leading the Future of the Book, or you can just Google Future of the Book, Springer Nature, and that information will come up. But back to your main question, and I will pull in our speakers again here now. So the question is, have you ever used both the hard copy as well as a digital copy? Some people find these combinations beneficial, and when you're purchasing the big bundles, were these combinations made available, or were they offered? I will come to John first and foremost.
So what we wind up doing with our approval plan is changing it so that it accounts for the big packages. So we are e-preferred in our approval plan in most cases, but then when we acquire a front list or something similar, we will not have those come on approval. Even as books, as print, but we will acquire a textbook for course reserves in print as well as online based on the way students study. And I think there are quite a few math faculty who have requested that the print book also be purchased. So I think in particular in my subject area, there's a heavy use of the print book.
Awesome, cool. Denise, did you want to comment?
Sure. We are also e-preferred, both in ordering firm and our approval plan, with the exception of like the arts. But if a faculty is insistent that we order paper, we will do that, but it's rather under duress because we really have no space for a print book.
Great, thank you. And Trish?
Yeah, just to echo some of the comments, when we purchased the archive, it did not come up as a combo. You get all the ebooks and acquire all the print because that's a massive volume of material. But similar to the others, we have the e-version now. We had a lot of the print already. If a request comes because there's greater awareness that these materials exist, someone wants a print copy, we will acquire it for them as well.
Perfect, thank you. I have one final question for our panelists, and I have one more question about that I will answer, and then we'll come to a close. I can see we've got 4.5 minutes left, so we're good for time, but we'll have a couple of minutes answering this question. So this comes from Marta. Thank you, Marta. So the question is regards the difference between usage of ebooks and the usage of print books. So let's just skip down. So the question was, would you say that usage of ebooks is more or less the same as print ones? For example, if you purchase just a quarter of the collection, would that fulfill most of your needs? Say you had like the print copies of the originals. So I guess it's just a comment on e-usage versus print usage. Could you do without one or the other? I will come to Denise first, if you'd like to comment.
We would purchase an ebook before we would purchase print.
Sure. And generally speaking, you think you would get more usage out of an ebook?
Yes, I do.
Yeah, cool. John, did you want to comment?
I think the scale is just dramatically higher. Again, ebooks they can discover through a web interface, through our discovery layer, through the catalog.
Yeah.
And they could have seen it on Amazon or something. And there's mm-hmm. more, it's an easier way to bridge to getting our ebook than it is to get to our print book.
Cool. And Trish?
Yeah, I would say the same. The ebook stats, just as a reminder, were chapter downloads, so you can't directly compare to print circulation. Just the example that I had included of the linear algebra, the introductory approach, to give you a sense, there were 2,500 chapter downloads. And for the print copy, which we've had, our stats go back to 2004, it had been checked out 67 times. So just in the 1 year, it leads me to believe that, you know, the e-version is certainly reaching a greater number of students than the print could, just because it's immediately accessible. If it's checked out, the print book is checked out, nobody else can view it, whereas the e-book is unlimited user access, so just a lot more accessible.
Awesome, thank you. I do have one, we have two more minutes, so if we can keep our answers succinct, but it's quite an interesting question and something I think we'd like to get your thoughts on. We still have a large number of participants with us. So Susanna asks, this is directed at John, but I'd like to open it up to all three of you guys. So I know there are many factors that go into student retention, but I'm curious if you've noticed a rise in student retention with the purchase of ebooks.
No, but thank you for that research inquiry line, because we are looking at the library's impact on student retention.
Okay, cool. And any other comments, Trish?
It is not something we have investigated, but yeah, it would be interesting to look into, certainly.
Cool, yeah, I agree. And Denise?
I think it sounds like a wonderful research
question,
because we haven't really looked at that.
Definitely. So if anyone out there is thinking about that research, that would be amazing. And please get in touch as well, because we'd be interested to be involved. So I will answer this final question about Spring and Nature, and then we will come to a close. So the question was very simply, are textbooks part of the Springer ebook archives? We found that textbooks are usually excluded. No, Springer textbooks are included in the archive as part of those collection packages. So we don't have any more time for questions, guys, but thank you. We have covered most. Thank you to those of you that have participated. I can see a large number of you are still with us, so again, thank you for that. I will just move the slide forward just to say
Well, first of all, to thank our speakers, Denise Novak from Carnegie Mellon, Trish Chatterley from University of Alberta, and John Meyer from Penn State University. As I'm sure you'll agree, those presentations were really, really useful and interesting, and the Q&A the last 20 minutes has been really engaging for me, so I hope it has for you guys as well. As Mark explained, this session will be recorded, and you'll be able to find that on YouTube. And I just encourage you guys, if you can, please do fill out the post-webinar survey. That's useful to the ACRL, and it's useful to us as well. So thanks very much for joining us today. Thanks for your time, and have a good rest of day.